I think we're ready.
All right, everybody, we are about ready to get started with our next presentation. All right, we're on a timeline now, so to most of you, Chris, three-screen diva Silvers, needs very little introduction. I'm just going to jump right in and let him take it from here. Master Social Engineer Chris Silvers is here to present to us on weapons of miniature destruction. You ready? Yeah. We're good?
You got it.
One projector, this is enough for you?
Just one.
We can pull out some more if you need.
Yeah, I'm sure you can, right. But it won't work. All right, everybody be quiet. There's music with this. Can y'all hear that?
Yeah.
Wonderful.
Yeah, but I thought I was going to get the heart shake.
All right, and if you didn't get that on by reading the words, here it is graphically. This may or may not be actual video taken by me. That's the security desk, by the way. All right, wonderful. Everybody laugh for Pat McCoy. Wonderful. All right, so this talk is called Weapons of Miniature Destruction, otherwise known as Three Reasons Why You Should Restrict Users and Use Full Disk Encryption. The format of this talk has changed in the last hour. So basically the design was to perform three demonstrations, mapping to the three reasons, right? And the format was, I was going to just tell you quickly about the scenario of what's in front of you as an attacker, a tool of choice based on that scenario, demonstrate that tool of choice, and then go into kind of a description of what happened and how it works and all that kind of good stuff. Given the time constraints we have here and the lack of hardware knowledge that I have, I guess, instead of having all those three demos, I'm going to do one demo. Sorry. Mostly because the laptop that I'm using actually has full disk encryption, and it's an effective protection against two of the demonstrations I was going to do, right? So if anybody would like to volunteer a laptop that doesn't have full disk encryption and happens to have FireWire port, hey, we'll rock it out, right? So we'll probably do it after the talk if you want to. Anyway. Exactly. And what I'm really trying to say is I didn't test the projector on my test laptop. That's what I'm trying to say.
I'm going to go see the talk in track two.
Okay, yeah. Go to track two. Ask for your money back while you're at it.
I volunteer Scott's laptop.
Wonderful. All right. Yeah. So, all right. So, scenario one. Okay, you're standing in the CEO's office. You don't have a lot of time, right? The workstation is locked, but you notice that there's either a FireWire port, an express card port, and something I didn't put up there, or a, is it lightning port? Is that what they?
Thunderbolt.
Sorry. Get them confused. Anyway, Thunderbolt port would also work, all right?
You know, FBI has a new card where they can actually just slap it into the machine live while it's running, and it'll install the drivers even if the system's locked. It can tap right into it even if it didn't have a
FireWire port. What kind of card?
They made it.
But physically, what kind of card? PCMCI Express card?
It's a PCI
USB?
It's a PCI slot.
PCI slot. So if,
PCI
okay.
Slot.
So if your laptop doesn't have a PCMCI card, then you're safe from the FBI. Wonderful.
I guess.
Yeah. Or if you just like glued it shut or something. I don't know.
It's a hoverboard.
You're just making a point.
Yep. As usual. All right. Wonderful. Yeah. It's magic. All right, so this is basically how easy it is. There's a tool out there called Inception.
The room's a little
You think?
You should see mine.
Your room or your testy?
Yes.
Yeah. I would make a comment, but I won't. All right. Basically, five steps to run Inception. Connect the firewall cable, start Inception, wait for about 5-6 minutes or so, hide under the desk, do whatever you need to do, and check if it worked. If it worked, step to step six and profit, all right? Because basically any password will work on the system, all right? If it didn't work, run it again, then it'll probably work. All right, so basically, imagine, Chris demoed that, and it took like 5 minutes, and he just got around a lot. Whoa, that was awesome. Wow. What the fuzzy just happened? Sorry, my daughter just walked in the room. I was going to just say. Okay. So basically, what this attack relies on is the serial bus port version 2 of direct memory access. And the reason Scott knows about it is because forensic guys use this all the time to dump memory, right? If you can do that. DMA, direct memory access, is essentially what FireWire uses to achieve those speeds that you get, the transfer speeds with FireWire. So Thunderbolt uses the same thing, and so that's why it's vulnerable. There's a few options within Inception. First, the default attack is basically to access the memory, find where the LSAS process is running, patch it so that the system will accept any password, and then move on with life. But you can also do memory dumping. That's the forensic choice there. You can also run it this thing called pickpocket mode, which is kind of cool. You basically connect it to a device that's a target that's running FireWire, and you can daisy chain other devices. So if another device happens to connect to the same either of the devices running FireWire, it will automatically run the default attack, right? So kind of like a drive-by type thing. A few caveats. Here's, obviously, so the limitation on Inception is 4 gig in the default attack. So if you have more than 4 gig of RAM, you run the risk of not being able to find the signature of in-memory where the LSAS process is running. And so then, obviously, it's not able to patch it because it can't find it, right? Another caveat is if you're actually going to dump memory, the reliable limit is 2 gig, right? So once again, if you have more than 8 gig, you've got a running shot of being protected from this attack. History-wise, anybody here remember what was that called? Win locked pwn. Anybody remember that? No? Okay. It was kind of a precursor to Inception that basically used some different methods that got patched in the Windows kernel. So no work in there. Protections, you can actually turn off FireWire, right? You can disable the protocol, but that kind of sucks because then you can't transfer stuff real fast. But you can also in OS X and in Windows, you can disable this SBP, the serial bus protocol, right? And it'll still work with FireWire drives, right? So regular drives, it's all good. All right. The source out there, if you're curious, is breakandenter.org. He's got a project called Inception. It's pretty easy to download and do and all that, install in Linux. All right. So scenario number two. You walk up to an unlocked workstation, right? And you're thinking, oh, goody. So then you go to a command prompt and you start trying to disable the antivirus. But lo and behold, you have some trouble. Like they've just protected antivirus. Even though, you did your privilege escalation, you became system, and you started trying to use task kill and killing services. And damn, if it just won't let you, right? Or you kill AV and then it comes back, right? They've actually locked that box down. It's really tight, all right? Here's my tool of choice. Anybody ever heard of VirtualBox? Yeah? Anybody ever heard of Portable VirtualBox? Yeah, it's pretty cool. Actually, as long as you're an administrator on the box, you can run Portable VirtualBox. you don't see why that would be useful? Okay, well, let me illustrate. All right, number one, you walk up to the system, you plug in a USB drive, a nice small one, though, because you're going to need to leave it in, right? Maybe around in the back or something like that. You plug that, you launch VirtualBox, you close. Yeah, careful insertion around the back of the dongle, right?
Make sure you leave it in.
Yeah, yes, you will be needing to leave it in, all right? No matter what you told her, you got to, okay?
Right, if you're going around
the back. All right. There's some kids in the room. All right, so you launch VirtualBox, you close Explorer because you don't want anybody to know that happened. You start your virtual machine, you hide VirtualBox, right, so it doesn't show up in the taskbar, minimized. Once you configure your VM, get you an IP address, run your little remote connection script out to your SSH server on the internet, then you can hide the virtual machine and then walk away. And then from anywhere on the internet, connect, get you a little reverse tunnel going into that box. All right? So let's see it, because this will be like the one demo. Here. This is why I like lapel mics.
For that profit bullet point, we need like a picture of you making it rain.
Yeah.
For real.
Good luck with that. All right. So.
We weren't at a strip club because someone didn't come with us to the Claremont last night.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
All right.
Somebody derailed our Claremont.
Timing
you.
Oh, yeah. Well,
all right. So, everybody, this is my son Benjamin, by the way. I think he's been given a handle of mini Poner, but anyway, whatever. So yes, he's assisting me by timing this demonstration to show just how long it takes to do this, okay? So he's going to start a 2-minute countdown. And did you start it? Okay. All right. And he's going to play some music. Okay, I'm hurrying. I'm doing this one-handed, even though I'm a little experienced with running a computer one-handed. Yeah, don't worry, Hannah. Don't worry about that joke.
Yeah. It's all right. She just laughed.
That was probably the best thing. All right. So we got to start up our little VM and pray to the VM gods. Okay, you're looking good there. Let's see. How about a control 4? Okay. Now, I don't know if you noticed in the very bottom, you probably couldn't see it, but anyway, you'll see in a second that, we're just going to run backtrack. It doesn't really matter. You can run any VM you want to run. All right, wonderful. Let's see. 1 minute, really? Already? Okay. All right. Y'all can see the screen up top, right? So I got to just kind of check, make sure what interface I got. Do I got DH client, maybe? No? Come on. CLI. There we go. Some music to hack by. Yeah. All right. Get a little DHCP address. Wonderful. 30 seconds. Come on. Oh, shit. Okay. Sorry. What's my remote, maybe? Yes. Okay. Boom. I hacked all the things. All right. So, did it blow up? What? Okay. So, where's my control 2? Okay, so I just hid and it's done. All right.
Woo!
Yeah. So you obviously can't see this in the back, but down there you don't see anything in the taskbar is being minimized other than my PowerPoint presentation, right? So the user comes back after 2 minutes or so, and yeah. And meanwhile,
I'm a little square instead of the clock.
Yeah, exactly. That's the only thing is he's going to say. Like, what is this little box right here? Because we know the typical user really inspects the taskbar very carefully every time they look at the computer, right? Right. Yeah, of course you do. And you are the typical user, Scott. Yeah, aren't you? Yeah. All right.
Chris,
Just saying.
Certificate warnings too, Scott.
I'm sure. All right. All right, he set the timer. All right, so what just happened? All right, 100% portable application, just runs from the SD card, doesn't really use the system resources, right? The biggest thing is that because portable VirtualBox is creating its own NAT interface within the software to interact with the network interface on the actual host, then it doesn't have to create another like virtual Ethernet interface, so it doesn't need as much access, so it doesn't have to be like system to do that, right? Now, it doesn't put you on the network that's attached to the laptop, right? It doesn't put you directly on, so you can't go do ARP spoofing and all that nice fun stuff, but you have a connection in there, and you have a full-fledged distro, not just like a Pwn plug or a mini Pwner or something like that, a kind of stripped down distro. You can put whatever VM you want, right? So you got all your tools right there, and then you just got an SSH shell reverse tunnel into it, right? And of course your auto connect script, you're also leveraging the power of the CPU on your host and the amount of RAM. So you know, this little ARM version 5 processor, right? You're leveraging the actual CPU on the victim box, so you can actually do some crunching and maybe some password cracking and, you know, all that good stuff, right? So the trick is the auto connect scripts, you know, work just like Pwn plug, etc. You can get around, use the Metasploit reverse tunnel or HTTPS, etc. Pretty easy to set up. Go out to www.vbox.me, download it, profit. All right. So scenario 3. What happens if you walk up to the workstation and, you know, it's either powered off or it appears that, you know, they've like rebooted or something, it's waiting to log on. So if they have USB booting enabled, right, and they haven't protected the BIOS to make that change, and if they don't have full disk encryption, right, tool of choice, of course, Conboot, right? I'm a huge fan. Pyotr makes some pretty good stuff, all right? Four-step, five-step profit, four-step process, insert dongle carefully. Crank. Yeah. Power on the PC, press enter. Seriously, press enter. When it comes up to the login prompt, if you know, you can log in as any user, right, if you want to, and then you can escalate privileges. Or you can just press the shift key 5 times in a row, and it will pop up a shell, a command shell, and that command shell is running under system privileges, right? Now, I'm not going to demo this because my laptop has full disk encryption, and it hoses up Conboot, right? It doesn't work, all right? So imagine that it did. Woo, wow, yeah, that's cool. Woo-hoo, wow, incredibly. So what the fuzzy just happened? All right, Conboot temporarily modified the master boot record, gave it a little patch, and said, if you get a password, it's fine by me. If you don't get a password, or if the user presses the shift key 5 times, give them a shell prompt. Give them a system level prompt, all right? So, as I mentioned, privilege escalation, got that, sticky keys. The source here is Pyotr Banya, which I misspelled, so don't do that. And his project, Conboot. All right. So in summary, yes, a question, sure. Yes. Actually, Pyotr has gotten a little more legit just recently, in the sense that I guess he sold enough of them to actually hire somebody to put together a decent website. But as far as I know, version 1, yeah, is still free. There's some limitations there, though. Version 1 only works on 32-bit operating systems. Okay, but seriously. If you want the bomb version 2.1, shell out the $15. okay? It's $15 freaking dollars, dude, okay? You know, yeah. And if you're, yeah, just use a gift card, you know, yeah. Yeah, exactly. So, you know, they have an enterprise license for $75. So, you know, get your boss to expense the $75 and then you can share it with all the employees, right? Yeah, no big deal. So, in summary, and this is like the fastest talk I've ever given, ask my wife. In summary, physical access to computer is winning, right? We all knew that anyway. The two main protections, though, that we somehow, some way, got to convince management to let us implement in security is, number one, we've got to start restricting users, giving them user access on, you know, only the level of access they need on the computer instead of just giving up and giving them admin rights, okay? Somehow we got to convince them of that. And then we've got to implement full disk encryption, not just on the laptops, right? On the workstations too. Yeah, I know it's kind of expensive, but hey, you know, what are you going to do, right? All right, thank you for your time. You can clap now, thank you. Wonderful. Here's my contact information. I do want to give a quick plug about a class I've been working on. It's within the Foundstone Ultimate Hacking series. It's called Ultimate Hacking Human. The first time it's going to be available in production anyway is at Black Hat. It'll also be available at DerbyCon.
Yeah, DerbyCon.
And McAfee Focus, yeah, whatever. But also at SkyDogCon. Yay, SkyDogCon. Woo! All right, wonderful. You had a question, yes.
Yeah. A couple of quick things to say.
Sure.
On the note of your virtualization, file catchers, they made a portable micro XP installation that uses QEMU, and it'll fire up a Windows XP without admin rights, and you could do whatever you want inside of it. It's like 300 megs or under 300 megs. So you you can bundle it into one executable. You run one executable that has whatever payload you want with a full rich Windows environment that you can do whatever you want to inside of it without admin rights. I also wanted to mention a quick kill script that I wrote that will escalate your, if you have admin rights, it'll escalate you to system, kill everything from that user. So it would kill every test that had the name administrator in it, and then you can go from there and do whatever you wanted to do. And then also from the standpoint of the full disk encryption, if you do have admin rights, I'm almost positive that the way the live Ubuntu install works, it uses that NTFS ghost stuff or something, and it's able to modify the boot sector while, like, real time while you're in Windows. So I'm thinking I'm probably sure somebody already knows that there's a way to, if you have admin rights, you can actually change it so where it boots to something else instead of the actual OS and have it do whatever shenanigans you want. As long as you have admin rights, you can write to it live, if it's NTFS, at least.
The NTFS thing, how it's like hanging loose.
Right, yeah. Everybody know that's the international symbol for NTFS, right? So I'll hang around a little while if anybody's interested in the FireWire demonstration or the Conboot demonstration. I just, for some reason, my laptop didn't want to hook up to a projector. So we can find a place somewhere if anybody's really interested in that demonstration. I'll be glad to do that. So thank you for your time.
I think you guys need to get together.
Yes.
Kids.
Yes, we do. Because that's an interesting attack vector. Right. Yeah. Yeah. And we can put together a talk and we'll practice it at a DC404 meeting. That's pretty much what I always do. Right next to the donation jar.
We're
all right.
Right next to the donation jar right now. Right. The donation jar comes to you.
All right.
Thank you, Chris.
Thank you for your time.